Good morning and welcome to Portadown Baptist Church virtually again this Sunday morning. If you're a regular with us, then it's good to have you back. Maybe you just came across us this morning on YouTube. If you did, that's brilliant. And we hope that as we meet together and you meet with us, that we will all know God's blessing this morning. I want to say thank you to our speaker for today, Billy Young. Billy was a pastor in one of our sister churches in Dungannon and then a pastor in a church in London for a number of years. And our thanks to Billy for sharing God's word with us this morning and again this evening. And to others who will also be involved in this morning's service, and I'll mention them in a minute or two. Well, here we are in May. We spent the whole of April in lockdown. A very different April than any of us would have imagined we would have spent. I hope you're keeping yourself safe. Don't forget about our Portadown Baptist Church care team. We are here for each other, and we want to help each other in whatever ways we can. And that includes you. Yes, it does include you. Please don't think by reaching out to us that you're just going to be a burden to us, because you're not going to be a burden. We want to help. Our volunteers are there to help you. So please reach out to Richard and he'll put you in contact with one of our volunteers. We continue to learn these new ways of doing things. And we want to thank our tech team, particularly for their input in putting these services and other things together. And we also want to thank you for your suggestions at how we might do these things better. You'll have seen that we did things a little bit differently on Wednesday evening. Going forward, we're going to put our Wednesday evening talks on YouTube, and then we will put the specific prayer points onto the church Facebook group. And we'll do that as much as we can going forward. Having said that, next Wednesday night is our Partners in Prayer night. And we're going to have to put that one on the private Facebook group. Next Wednesday night, we're going to have a video from Timothy Tai, who works with the Barnabas Fund. And it'll, as will become obvious when you watch the video next Wednesday evening, we have to keep that one on the Facebook group. So please do remember that for Wednesday night. And also, with it being Partners in Prayer, our monthly Partners in Prayer update will be available on the church Facebook private group as well. Or if you want to get one of those by email, then please email your request to online@portadownbaptist.com and we'll send you a copy. Why not set up a prayer group for Wednesday nights? Maybe a couple of couples, or maybe a small group of you get together through a WhatsApp video call or through a Teams meeting or through a Zoom meeting. Just get together to pray together in a group. Now, we have been doing that in our home group, just on Wednesday nights, just coming together and praying together. Maybe you'd like to join us. You don't have to be part of a home group. Maybe you'd like to join us and just pray with us as we do that, and you'd be very welcome. Just let any of the home group leaders know. That's Raymond, Paul, Stephen Hunter, Gavin Woods, or myself, and we'll be more than happy to set things up for you and get you invited. We're also going to do things a little bit differently tonight as well. I wonder, have you been missing our tea and bickies after the evening service? Well, tonight, if you've been missing them, we're going to have tea and bickies after our service. Going to keep the YouTube chat open at the end of the sermon for you to chat. Maybe chat about the sermon, maybe about some of the different things you've been doing during the lockdown. Maybe just to say hi and let us know how you're doing, how you're keeping. I'm afraid you're going to have to provide your own tea and bickies this Sunday evening, but sorry about that, but nothing we can do. Now, I want you to do something for me. Well, will you do it for me? Well, I hear you saying, well, tell us what it is, Stephen, and then we'll decide. Well, what I want you to do for me is I want you to put together a short video of yourselves, just 10 seconds long, telling us who you are, saying hello, welcoming us to our Sunday morning service. Whether it's just two of you, or whether it's a whole family, whether you're young, middle-aged, or maybe a little bit older than that, we want to see you. We miss seeing each other, and we want to see you. Just 10 seconds long, just a very short video. Do it out in your garden, do it sitting in your living room, do it wherever is comfortable for you. Just a short 10-second clip saying hi, tell us who you are, and say welcome to our Sunday morning service. And then email your video to online@portadownbaptist.com, and we'll put a bunch of them together and show them on Sunday mornings before the service starts. Now, do remember, when you're videoing, please hold your phone like this and not like this. Okay? Now, you won't let me down, will you? Let's get the videos rolling in, streaming in, so we can put them together. The boys and girls, in a short while, Pauline has something she wants to say to you. And then after Cheryl and Ryan and Sophie lead us in a song, the Bible class have something they want to share with us this morning as well. And then we'll hand over to our speaker, Billy Young, and he will minister to us. Maybe before these Sunday services start, you find yourself looking at the picture of our church building and wondering to yourself how long it will be before we stand together again and hear all our voices praising God together. We want to be together again, don't we? In the book of Romans, Paul writes to people he has never met before, people who live in a place that he has never been to before, but he longs to be with them. And he says this to them as he begins to write to them, as God inspires Paul to write to these Christians in Rome. He says this to them in Romans 1, 10 to 12. He says, I pray that now at last, by God's will, the way may be open for me to come to you. I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to make you strong. That is, that you and I might be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. Paul's longing, his heart's desire, was to be with these Christians. He longs to meet with his brothers and sisters, his family in Jesus Christ, in that great city of Rome. He tells them he prays for it all the time, that one day he will be able to meet with them. He had hoped to be with them before, but the timing wasn't right, and so he waited. But he tells them that he longs to meet them, longs to be with them. And he tells them why he longs to meet them, why he has this desire, this strong urge to be with them. He says it's that he might bring them some encouragement, something that would strengthen their faith. But more than that, he says he desires to be with them so that they might encourage him as he encourages them, that they might encourage each other. But the timing isn't right. But he just doesn't wait. He writes to them. The things that he would love to say and longs to say to them in person, he writes to them to encourage them. And what an encouragement it was to them, and what an encouragement it is to us. We have it now as the book of Romans. It's not a pleasant thing to be apart. We want to be together. We're made to be together. But the timing just isn't right. One day it will be. And as the Queen reminded us, we will meet again. But in the meantime, let's keep encouraging each other. Paul had to write a letter. He didn't have a telephone or video calling or Zoom meetings. But we do. Let's keep in touch with each other. A quick phone call. A video call to say, hi, how are you? You never know, but that might just be the strength that that person you call needs. That might just be the encouragement that their heart needs just to get them through that day. In a moment, I'm going to hand over to Pauline, but before I do that, I just want us to pray together. So let's pray. Father, it's so good to know that lockdown is not something that affects you. While we experience restriction, you know no limits. While we maintain social distancing, you still come right alongside us. While we struggle to get used to the new normal, nothing about you has changed. You remain the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. We see change in everything around us, but nothing changes you. Lord, grant us perseverance. Give us the patience we need to see this thing through. Guide us as we walk these new unknown paths that lie ahead of us. As your word will remind us this morning, so often you come to your people and tell them not to be afraid. Lord, help us not to be afraid. Lord, we pray this morning for each other. We love one another and we miss one another. But Lord, we want to be there for each other as best we can. May we be encouragers to each other through a telephone call or a video chat. May the bonds that tie us together hold us tight together. We continue to pray for those we know who continue to experience the pain of loss of a loved one. Lord, may they know you to be their comfort and their strength. For those anxious for themselves or family members on the front line in this pandemic, Lord, grant them your peace in place of worry. For those facing a very uncertain future in terms of jobs or businesses, Lord, help us to put our confidence in you and face an uncertain future sure in you. Lord, as we worship together this morning, through your Spirit, unite us as one, we pray. Cause us to rejoice in your goodness to us. As others share with us this morning, as we listen to your word proclaimed, fill our hearts with joy in you, we pray. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, All Stars. I am so pleased that you have turned up this morning because I am missing you. And I wanted to share a verse with you that's found in Psalm 46, verse 10. And it says, "Be still and know that I am God." What does be still mean? Well, be still means to slow down or to stop. And we've all had to slow down and stop, haven't we, this past few weeks? You know, when we slow down and stop, often we see things a little bit different around us. We've spent lots of time out in our garden in sunny days, and we have had our cat spending lots of time with us in the garden too. This is Theo. Theo is our family cat, and we have noticed some beautiful things about Theo that we wanted to share with you. Firstly, look at his fur. Theo has got a fur coat. Can you believe that? It's like he has a coat on, and it's all fur. And this coat is amazing. It has so many colours in it. And when you look at all of the colours, you see stripes as well. He's like a mini tiger. And if you look at your animal that you maybe have at home, or an animal in a field beside you, you'll see that they have their own coat on as well. And it is actually amazing to see how different they all are. We don't have to do anything to look after Theo's fur. Theo cleans it himself. We don't ever need to bath him. We do brush him because he enjoys being brushed, but he keeps himself so clean. The other amazing thing about Theo is his little nose. Theo, can we see your nose? Let's see your nose. Theo's got a tiny pink nose. And this nose is amazing too, because just like you have a fingerprint that is totally unique to you, Theo's nose is totally unique to him. The print on his nose, no other cat in the world has it. Unreal. Such a tiny little thing, and yet so special. The other thing that is unique about Theo, and we've heard lots of it this last few weeks, is his wee noise. Theo, what noise do you make? Can you tell us what noise you make? Meow. If I ask you a question, do you like playing in the garden, Theo? He's not going to speak. Boys and girls, tell me what noise that Theo makes. I heard it. Meow. That is right. And when you look at the animals that you have around you, they will all make their own noise too. It's fantastic, all these different sounds. Do you know, when we look at Theo and we're amazed by the many things around or about Theo, do you know what it makes us think about? Who created you, Theo? And when we read Genesis 1 verse 25, we see that God created Theo. That God created the wild animals, the tame animals, and all the small creeping animals. And when we look at you, Theo, and we're amazed, we're totally amazed at God too, because he made you, and he made you as special as you are. Boys and girls, I would love for you this morning or this afternoon to look at the animal that you have near you. Maybe draw a picture of it. Put all the amazing things on the picture. Put the colour of its coat and what it looks like. Put its tiny nose and what it looks like. Put the sound coming out of its mouth and what it's saying, meow. And then remember who created that animal. It was God. Say thank you to God for that. Be amazed by that. And in these days where we have to be still, let's look at the amazing blessings that he has given around us for us to enjoy. See you soon, boys and girls. And if you've any of these pictures that you would like to share with me, why don't you get your mum or your dad to send them to me on a little message? My number is in the church directory and they can get it there.
Thank you. Psalm 8. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings, that you care for them.
You made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honour. You made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet, all flocks and herds, the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, all that swim the paths of the seas. O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He refreshes my soul.
He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows.
Surely your goodness and love will follow me all these days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the name of the Lord forever.
Psalm 40 verses 1 to 5. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand.
He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him.
Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, who does not look to the proud or to those who turn aside to false gods.
Many, Lord my God, are the wonders you have done, things you have planned for us. None can compare with you. Were I to speak and tell of your deeds, there would be too many to declare.
Oh, the joys of those who are kind to the poor. The Lord rescues them when they are in trouble. The Lord protects them and keeps them alive. He gives them prosperity in the land and rescues them from their enemies. The Lord nurses them when they are sick and restores them to health. O Lord, I prayed, have mercy on me, heal me, for I have sinned against you.
Vindicate me, O God, and plead my cause against an ungodly nation. Rescue me from deceitful and wicked men. You are God, my stronghold. Why have you rejected me? Why must I go about mourning, oppressed by the enemy?
Send me your light and your faithful care. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy mountain, the place where you dwell. Then I will go to the altar of God, to God, my joy and my delight. I praise you with the lyre, O God, my God.
Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Saviour and my God.
Good morning. It is good to be with you in worship in Portadown once again, even if it is at a distance. Our reading this morning is from Genesis chapter 15 and reading the whole chapter. And this is what God's word says. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision. Fear not, Abram, I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, Behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household will be my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. This man shall not be your heir. Your very own son shall be your heir. And he brought him outside and said, "Look toward heaven and number the stars if you are able to number them." Then he said to him, "So shall your offspring be." And he believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness. And he said to him, "I am the Lord who brought you out from Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess." But he said, "O Lord, how am I to know that I shall possess it?" He said to him, "Bring me a heifer 3 years old, a female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon." And he brought him all these, cut them in half, and laid each half over against the other. But he did not cut the birds in half. And when the birds of prey came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. As the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell on Abram. And behold, dreadful and great darkness fell upon him. Then the Lord said to Abram, "Know for certain that your offspring will be sojourners in a land that is not theirs, and will be servants there, and they will be afflicted for 400 years. But I will bring judgment on the nation that they serve, and afterward they shall come out with great possessions. As for you, you shall go to your fathers in peace. You shall be buried in a good old age, and they shall come back here in the fourth generation, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete." When the sun had gone down and it was dark, behold, a smoking firepot and a flaming torch passed between these pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, "To your offspring I give this land, from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates, the land of the Canaanites, the Kenizzites, the Kadamites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, and the Rephaim, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Girgashites, and the Jebusites." And thus says the word of God. Times of victory are wonderful. When things are going well, it's terrific. Adrenaline can flow and spirits can soar. Especially if we feel a victory has been won in an honourable way against odds that were all against us. As we enter this chapter, you would think that Abram has every reason to feel good about himself. He has just had the most incredible victory. He has achieved everything he set out to do. He has rescued his nephew from an enemy that seemed so powerful. He has received the blessing of a strange high priest called Melchizedek. But something is bothering Abram. He lives as a wealthy man in a land which isn't his. He's a nomad travelling from place to place with his sheep, trying to find water for them, trying to find pasture for them. Long, long ago, God gave him promises. And these promises were wonderful. And Abram acted on these promises and left where he lived in Ur of the Chaldees and came to this land of Canaan, expecting God to fulfill all that he had said to him. I think we perhaps tend to think that God is in touch with Abram every day. And Abram constantly talks to God and has his presence. That's not the case. Years would go past before God would come and speak to Abram. And during that time, Abram was expected to walk in the light of the word that God has given him, in the faith that he had given him. When that happens, you tend to wonder how God will work things out. I'm doing a lot of wondering at the minute. Never lived in a situation before where I am have to stay in my home and only go out for shopping or for exercise once a day. It's strange, and I wonder, what is God about? You might be tempted to wonder, has God forgotten us? What are God's purposes in this? All these things must have gone through Abram's mind. And we don't know how long it is after these things, as the first verse of chapter 15 tells us, that the Lord came to Abram in this vision. It might be the next day, it could be a year, but it was after these things had happened. And God comes to speak to him. And he says a wonderful thing to him. He tells him not to be afraid. It is amazing how many times in the Bible that the Lord comes and tells people not to be afraid. One of the greatest times, of course, was at the first Christmas when shepherds were out in the fields and suddenly there was this angel in front of them and the angel said, "Fear not, for I have come to bring you great tidings of great joy." Why would he say fear not? Well, the reason is obvious. They were afraid. They were terrified. Our situation at the minute is very frightening. And in that fear, the Lord came to Abram and said to him, "I am your shield." In other words, I am your protector. I am the one who will go before you. I will hold my shield in front of you as you advance. And your reward will be very great. God was coming to tell him again that everything I have promised you, everything I have said, will be yours. But Abram has a problem. I think one of the lovely things about this is that Abram has such a relationship with God that he can question him. He can ask him questions. He can bring to him the things that bother him. Sometimes when we don't understand the Lord and we are questioning, we might feel a sense of guilt that we can even question our God, that we can even wonder what he's about. A pastor long ago once told me that our God is so great that he allows us to misunderstand his motives and misunderstand his purposes and still love us. Abram here has a question for God. After this lovely beginning to this vision, you would imagine him to fall down and worship, but he says quite respectfully, "What will you give me? For I continue childless. You have promised me a great nation will come from me, and I have no children. And the heir of everything I have, the one who will inherit while I die, is Eliezer of Damascus. Is this what you mean to happen, O God?" is the question. "You have given me no offspring." The name Abram means mighty father. It must have seemed very ironic to Abram to have that name when he had no children. It must have been an embarrassment to him as well. If Sarah was to call him in the evening and shout "Abram," and all the people would smile, "There he goes, mighty father, the one who has no children to his name." Abram said, "You promised me this. And where is it?" And the God is good. God comes and gives him reassurance that Eliezer will not be his heir, but your very own son shall be your heir. Not only that, he brings him out and shows him the stars of the sky. He says, "Count them." Well, Abram, if he could probably have counted between 2,000 and 3,000 stars that he could see with his naked eye. Would those be the number of his offspring? We know that another time the Lord said that as the grains of sand on the seashore, Abram must have thought that was many, many more than the stars in the sky. but we now know that the stars in the sky are as countless as the grains of sand on the seashore. Such is God's promise. This will be your reward, Abram. This will be your nation of people. And here's the wonderful thing in verse 6. Abram believed him, and the Lord counted that to him as righteousness. His relationship with the Lord was based on belief. And belief is what we need to be the Lord Jesus Christ. One of the most famous verses in the Bible, perhaps the most famous verse in the Bible, of course, is John 3:16, which says that God so loved the world that whosoever believes in him. And that belief, of course, is not an acknowledgement that he's there. It's not some vague idea that he's in the atmosphere around us, that he exists. No, that word belief means to put your trust in, to rely on, to know the truth. That's what Abram does. And the Lord counted that to him as righteous. He was made righteous through his belief. Now, belief is different to understanding. Abram still did not understand. We see that as the chapters of Genesis go on ahead of us, because he tries to force God's hand. He tries to make God's purpose come true in his life by his own efforts. He believed, but did not understand. In the days that we live in, I don't think any of us understand what is happening. I don't think any of us understand what God's purpose in this may be. But can you believe and trust in him? He said we have to believe in him, that he died and rose again. We can believe that without understanding how it came about. Abram believed. It was counted to him as righteousness. What about my child? There's your answer, Abram. Believe that I will make your offspring as numerous as the stars in the sky. Well, okay. That's part of the promise that God had given Abram long ago. Now he comes to the next one. He says, God says to him, I am the Lord who brought you out from the Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land. And of course, Abram didn't own any land. He continued not to know any land. Indeed, on the day of his death, all that Abraham owned in the land of Cana was a field that he had bought from the sons of Machpelah, in which was a cave in which he buried Sarah and in which he himself was buried. He owned a grave. He owned nothing else. How would he have this land to possess? That just seemed too far beyond anything that he could trust in. Well, in answer to that, God does something strange. Abram is to bring to him a heifer, 3 years old, a goat, 3 years old, a ram, 3 years old, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. And when he brings them, he's to kill them and cut them in half and put them on the ground beside each other. And the two birds are not cut in half, but are put side by side. This is a sacrifice, an expensive sacrifice, in a time before the institution of the sacrifices were given to Moses. That was a long way off. And Abram does that. It's easy to read those verses without imagining what that was like. Killing these animals, cutting them in two. It must have looked like carnage. There must have been blood everywhere, and Abram must have been covered in it. But he does it. Not only that, of course, as soon as these dead animals are put out, then the birds of prey come down on them. Of course they will. They will do that. And Abram has to chase them away. And then when the sun goes down, a deep sleep falls on him. And a great of an awful darkness comes over him. This becomes a place, a fearsome place of darkness and horror. I don't think we can go too far wrong if we compare this to the great sacrifice that was to come. Whenever Moses instituted under God the tabernacle and the sacrificial system, these sacrifices went on day by day, thousands of them. Whenever Solomon put his temple in place, 100,000 sheep slaughtered in one day to bring this temple into being. And none of those sacrifices could take away the sin of the human heart. It could satisfy temporarily, but sin remained. So God brought into the world his Son, who lived a holy and spotless life, who, though tempted, never sinned, never fell, never gave in, and who was taken and put on the cross, that place of darkness, that place of horror, with all those around him mocking him, doing all they could to make his situation worse. And our Saviour was there in that darkness. I think this is a forerunner of what God was going to do for us with the Lord Jesus. Abram falls into a deep sleep. And in that sleep, the Lord comes and tells him a prophecy. Know for certain that your offspring will be sojourners in a land that is not theirs. They'll be servants there, slaves there, and they'll be afflicted for 400 years. We know the truth of that. We know that after Abram came his son Isaac, and after Isaac came the two sons, Jacob and Esau. We know how Jacob had the 12 boys and the one girl, how there was jealousy among them, how they sold one of them, Joseph, into slavery, and he ends up in Egypt and through amazing circumstances becomes prime minister. And then there's a famine, and then his sons are sent down to Egypt, and they meet Jacob, they meet Joseph again, and through Joseph they're saved and brought down to live in Egypt. They didn't know how long they were going to be there, but for 400 years they live in Egypt, becoming slaves to the Egyptians. And then God says, I will bring judgment on the nation they serve. And if you read into the book of Exodus, you will read the judgments that God brought on the nation of Egypt. God keeps his promises fully. But as for the nation, they would come out with great possessions. Whenever they were leaving Egypt, the people of Egypt were eager to give them all that they had just to get them out. And they left Egypt with 400 years' wages in their pockets. They did not go out empty. But as for Abram, the prophecy goes that you will be buried in a good old age. But his people would come back in the fourth generation, when God's timing was right, when the iniquity of the Amorites was complete. There were the promises. There are promises at the cross for us. Jesus promised that he would rise again from the dead, and he did. He promised through the angels as he was going into heaven that he would return in the same way that he had gone, and he would take all those who trusted and believed in him to be with him where he is. What wonderful promises God still has to fulfill for us. But the day with Abram here is ending. The sun is going down and it's getting dark, and there's a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch that comes. This is the presence of God. This is the person of God. And it passes between these pieces. What's the symbolism of that? Well, it would have been familiar to the people of Abram's day and the people who followed Abram that when you did a business deal with someone, you may take an animal and kill it, and you would put one half of the animal on one side and one half of the other, and then together the people who had made the covenant would pass between the dead animal. And the symbolism was obvious. If one of us breaks this deal, if one of us breaks this promise, this covenant between us, let it happen to him as has happened to these animals. That's the covenant. That's the promise. And as God goes through here, we find in verse 18 that he makes a promise to Abram saying, I will give your offspring this land. And the land is, the borders of that land are given to him. This wonderful promise of God that this would he would have one day. But here's the interesting thing. Only God passes through that covenant. Only God is the one who keeps it. Abram is left out of this. Why is that? Because he could not keep this covenant. God makes it on his own for him. Now, you and I can do nothing to make ourselves right with God. We can make all sorts of promises with him that we will. Oh Lord, if you do this for me, then I will do this for you. Lord, I want to earn your respect. Let me do it this way. Whenever we do that, we forget the nature of our God. Sometimes whenever we come to worship, we can feel that we are doing God a favour. That we're saying to him, look how wonderful our singing is. Look how wonderful our worship is. Lord, please accept what we are giving you. That is not how we come and worship. We bring nothing. Our full relationship with God should be one of gratitude. Nothing else. We bring nothing to the party. We bring nothing to the situation. Abram here did nothing to help fulfill these promises of God. God made them to him, and all Abraham had to do was to believe in those promises. When Jesus died on the cross, he died there alone for me. It was without me, and yet it was as if I was there. When Jesus died on the cross, he took my sin. I was crucified there with him. He made the covenant, and all I have had to do is to trust and to believe that what he said is true. I trust in his promises. I believe in his promises. If I forget that God has done this for me, then I lose my place with him. Our prayer should be that we live in gratitude to God. So his people would one day come back to this land. God would fulfill all his promises. And whatever we are going through in this time of corona, God has still made promises to us. And one day this will be over. And this will be past. I don't know what that's going to look like now, but I suspect the world that we come out into will be different from the world in which we entered this time. But God will still be God. His promises will still be his promises. And our trust in him will still be our trust in him. and he will keep his promises, whatever. So what does this passage have to tell us? Our God so loved us that he sent the ultimate sacrifice, so that if we trust and believe, he will keep all his promises to us. My prayer is that in these days, you will know his promises. You will eagerly want to see him fulfill them. And that every day you will be grateful to him for the covenant that he has made with you in Christ. Amen.
Lord, I'll worship your holy name.
Our thanks to Billy for bringing God's word to us this morning and for reminding us of the certainty of God's promises. As we bring our time together this morning to an end, let's just pray. Let's pray together. Lord, we praise you that your promises are sure and certain. We are so glad that your promises depend on you and not on us. Even when we either don't understand or even misunderstand your purposes, Father, we thank you and we bless you that your promises remain as sure and as unchanging as you yourself. We thank you for the greatest of all your promises, a promise that if we confess our sins in Jesus Christ, we will know your forgiveness and we will experience your salvation. We thank you for the covenant you have made with us through him, through his death on the cross. Father, your promises are precious to us. We pray this morning that they will hold us through these difficult days. Help us to stand on your promises, even when we don't understand what's happening around us. We thank you that your promises are sure and certain. Father, bless us through the rest of this day, we pray. We pray your hand upon us. We look forward to meeting again this evening as we worship together and as we listen to your word this evening as well. Lord, bless us, we pray. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.